Good. How are we doing today? Good. As we get ready to get started, the first thing I'd like to do is thank, and I'd like everyone to help me thank Rudy and Bonjean for doing this great job of putting this together. You know, anyone that's ever tried to put together a seminar or a speaking engagement knows what it's like to try to, basically to me, it's like herding cats. You know, it starts well, but it's a lot harder than it looks. And I'd also like everyone to thank Vern for starting this organization in the original so we could share ideas, because there's nothing better than getting with like-minded people so you can share ideas and concepts and be on a peer level, whether that's entrepreneurs, psychologists, hypnotherapists, whatever it happens to be. A peer organization is where you need to be, and someone has to start these. So let's all thank Vern for starting this originally and doing that. So what we're going to do today is go over some of the dynamics of influence. And as we get ready to get started, I'd like to ask everyone to do one thing for me real quick. And that is just take out a piece of paper and write down two or three people that you think are very good communicators, very persuasive communicators, that you like and that you respect and that, you know, you'd like to be like. Somebody you really like as a communicator, as a persuader, a speaker. Could be in business, could be in politics, could be in anything. Just a couple of people real quick, write down that you like and admire. Good. Doesn't matter who they are. Great. Now what I'd like you to do is maybe write down one person that maybe you don't like, but you have to admit they're a good communicator. Because when you begin to study the art of influence and communication, one of the mistakes people make is they discount what a person does if they don't like them personally. They don't take the tools that they're doing that makes them a good communicator, and they don't study that and take from it. They write off the whole thing. So what I ask you to do is just think about, again, maybe somebody you don't really like that much, but you have to admit they're a good communicator. And then look at that list again, somebody, these communicators that you like, and then someone maybe you're not too familiar with or you don't like, but you have to admit they're a communicator. And realize that as you look at that person, that those ideas, as you look at this person that's a good communicator, as you take this is what we want to begin to model so you can become the kind of communicator that you want to be. Now, why should you learn the art of influence and communication? Well, I would say it boils down to one thing and one thing only, and that's effectiveness. The better communicator you are, the more effective you are in every aspect of your life, not just business. You know, if you're a parent, and I know a lot of parents in the room, it'll make you a better communicator when it comes to dealing with your children or your spouses. How many people here are married or in a long-term relationship, right? Now, let me ask you, have you ever had communication problems on the home front? You ever had? No. Oh, you're a saint, sir. I don't, you know, I've been married 20 years, and sometimes it's interesting, and I'm supposed to be a good communicator. But you get those miscommunications, you know, what's meant and what's understood are two different things. But if you become a better communicator, it'll help you in your home life as well, of course, as your business life. Now, as business people, as entrepreneurs, as executives, you have to deal with a wide variety of people. How do you motivate different people at different times to do different things, even though you're going toward the same goal? This is one of the problems that we run into as communicators. So this is why you should learn it. Now, how we're going to do it today, of course, today's just like a taste, and we're going to give you some tools. But one of the things I want you to have when you leave here is at least a couple of different things that you can put in your pocket and begin to implement. Because I do not think it's very effective to sit through a seminar and just get head knowledge unless you can drop it down into the biology, if you will, into the physiology and do it. So I've kind of revamped how I'm going to do it so you can leave here with a few ideas that you can take starting today, right now, and begin to make yourself a better communicator based on studying effective communicators all over the world that I've worked with and had the pleasure of studying. And I have a unique advantage, if you will, and I've been blessed. Because I've studied hypnosis and neuro-linguistics, I began to realize that there are some very basic things that the good communicators do across the board. Regardless of their message, you could put the message over here, how they're doing it is pretty similar. And if we can synthesize that out like an operating system, you can duplicate it. And you can take that and you can run with it. And I'll show you a couple of examples as we get going. So the way I use it is called applied NLP. You know, NLP is a big word, a lot of people heard of it. But what I talk about is a communication tool. It's a transformational tool. It's to make you a better communicator and put you in a state of excellence so you can help other people make changes. And I use applied NLP. I don't talk a lot about theory. I don't talk a lot about esoteric thoughts and things like that. I want what I call down and dirty NLP. I want stuff that works, whether you're sitting in a sales meeting or doing an employee evaluation or talking to your spouse. I want stuff that works in the real world. You know, and that's the thing I find the most effective. You know, when I was in the military, I was trained in basically covert operations, right? And what that is all about is getting the job done. The number one thing is getting the job done, not necessarily how you do it. Do you accomplish your mission? Did you succeed, yes or no? And across all the special ops communities, they always talk about one thing: failure is not an option, right? And I took that into my heart, and it kind of makes things different. You know, so if I go into a situation, I'm going into it to do the best that I can with the idea that failure is not an option, right? And so if you take that attitude, it'll begin to just change a little bit about how you're doing things. So as you begin to look at this, you begin to wonder, does subconscious influence work? Can you influence people at the subconscious level? I think you can. I see it all the time. But sometimes you get skeptics in the room, you know, like, will this work on me? Everybody thinks they're too smart to be influenced at the subconscious level. And actually, all the research says one thing, which is the smarter you are and the more educated you are, the easier you are to be persuaded at the emotional level. Let me repeat that. The smarter you are and the more educated you are, the easier you are to be influenced, and if you want to say manipulated, at the emotional level, if the person knows how to do it. Because they'll use your intellect and your education against you. Not against you, but they'll use it so they can set it aside and help you do things, or basically do what you want them to do. So if you want to play this one.
American shopping malls, modern cathedrals to spending money. They're designed to disorient us and make us stay longer than we need to. Every brick is there to manipulate us to buy. It's the perfect place to find a large number of compliant people to affect.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Palisades Mall. We hope that your shopping experience is an uplifting one, and I'd like to bring to your pay attention some very special offers today.
What you're hearing in the background is a public address announcement I've pre-recorded and played throughout the shopping center. After about half an hour of absorbing it, they should be ready for their final message. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Palisades Mall. We hope that your shopping experience is an uplifting one, and I'd like to bring to your pay attention some very special offers today. Details of our special offers can be found handily by the elevators, so why not come right on up and see for yourselves. Our special offers will only be available for a short period of time, so all those customers wishing to reach up and grab this exciting opportunity should do so now.
I don't know, like, everybody raised their hand. It was just weird, because I'm walking around, he's like, now, and everybody raised their hand.
Someone gave me a phone call, and I was talking to my friend. He was talking to me, and the guy was like, do it now. I put my hand up. And then when I turned around, everybody was doing the same gesture, and I was like, what was going on?
We were walking around, and we heard the noun card, and all of a sudden, we all raised our hands.
It was weird.
We turned around, and that, like, everyone had their hands up in the air. Really weird.
We had our hands up, too.
Really odd.
Sorry.
That's an example of getting people to respond at a subconscious level. Now, when I show that, some people go, oh, I'd never do that. You know, that wouldn't work on me. Do you stop at a red light when you're driving your car without thinking about it? Right? That's a subconscious response that's been programmed in. If you watch how he set this up, it took a couple of hours, and there was a lot of things going on behind the scenes with subliminal advertising and messages all over the shopping mall to get people to do this. But it works, because if you're bombarded with some ideas, they become second nature. Another example would be, I don't think there's any place in the developed or the developing world that if they saw the golden arches, they do not know what that stands for. Correct? It becomes subconscious, it becomes second nature. And so what we want to do is begin to understand what makes people tick at a subconscious level. Not consciously, but subconsciously, because this is the key to truly effective communication. But let's make it more personal, you know? So what are some of the challenges that you as CEOs, directors, entrepreneurs, presidents face in the current business environment? Just shout out a couple things. Quiet group. All right, I'll just jump to what I already have. All right, good. Growth and expansion, right? Growth. Can people keep up with the CEO or the person that started the company with your growth ambitions? How many of you have ever been slowed down by the team thinking that you're growing too fast? Has this ever happened to anybody? Right? So, and again, how fast is too fast when you're growing an organization? I don't know. It probably depends on the organization, things like that. But this is one of the problems that we face as we're growing a business. You know, the next problem would be sticking it out, survivability, sustainability, doing more with less, you know. Do you keep, as it says there, the not-so-cute secretary, or do you keep the effective, you know, do you keep the effective secretary or the cute secretary? Do you keep your buddy, who's a salesman, because you hired him when things were going great and you could afford it? Do you keep him as things slow down, or do you keep the person that's a highly producing salesman? You know, so how do you do this? And of course, how do you find new revenue streams as you're producing and as you're growing and as you're doing these things? These are some of the things that we have and that you have to work with. The next thing is getting going again, post-crisis, because with the current economic crisis in the world, we're kind of stuck in that, a lot of us, in the survivability and sticking it out, trying to grow, trying to make our business survive till it starts to grow. And it's starting to grow. Of course, here it's a little bit better than where I'm from right now. But as you begin to come out of the crisis, the post-crisis, how do you grow? How do you get people to go from that fear state, which the economy, when it slows down, puts people in a fear state, you know, so it's hard to get them to take action, hard to get them motivated. How do you get them motivated to come out of that and go back into being motivated so you can rally them and get them to take action? You know, can you do more with less resources? Can you accomplish more? Even as you're growing, this is where a lot of companies actually, a slowdown, it sounds terrible, but it's true. As you slow down, you cut back your workforce a little bit, and then as you start growing, you can become more profitable because you can do more with less. Because sometimes, you know, when things are booming and you're growing fast, you overhire, you let people that may not be the best producers stick around because you just need the bodies, things like that. And so now you can come out of that. So can you get more done with less resources, right? And lastly, overcoming the negative public persona that bombards us. You know, it's one of the things we have to deal with. You know, when you pick up the paper, when you pick up the news, everything's about how bad it is. You know, now it's starting to pick up, but we have to constantly overcome this. This is things that we work with and that we face all the time. And of course, the worst case scenario is starting over. But if you're in a position of starting over, you know, how do you use that to your advantage? How do you maintain the positive contacts that you had in the business when it was booming, and now if you had to start over, can you maintain those positive contacts? And maybe key people keep in touch with, because if you get a new opportunity, if you start a new business, you want to bring some of the best people with you. So you want to leave a good taste with them, if you want to say that, so you can start over, right? And of course, you know, recover maximum value from the remaining assets. How can you do these kind of things? So these are some of the ideas that you may have to work with. So what we want to do is get the best possible change. The execution of change is what it's about. I like to say what I teach people to do is become compliance engineers, to get people to comply with what you want to do. Because a truly effective leader must be a great communicator, organizer, and be able to organize and communicate on different levels to different people. One of the problems is, as communicators, we communicate best with people who are like us, which is okay, maybe for your inner circle, but as it expands out, as it grows, can you communicate with a wide variety of people? Can you influence people that are not like you, whether culturally or emotionally or whatever it happens to be? And again, people are the key. As said at the beginning, you know, people are the key. We always say that, but do you act it? Do you walk the talk? When you say people are our best asset, most companies say that, correct? But do you really walk the talk when it comes that way, you know? And lastly, you know, I have to give you all credit because you're here, so you're personally improving yourselves by coming to an organization like this, by devoting